So in the last few lectures on this particular unit on logic family, we have primarily talked about the register transistor logic and diode transistor logic, that is RTL and DTL respectively. And you have already found that there are several disadvantages associated with DTL logic, and hence that logic was ultimately improvised by means of TTL, which is known as the transistor logic, and then ultimately ECL, that is emitter coupled logic. But all of them, DTL, RTL, TTL, and ECL, they are based on the bipolar junction transistor, that is BJT. In fact, in your lab, in electronics lab, we do different types of experiments, chip-based experiments, like experiment on the verification of AND gate, experiment on the verification of the truth table of XOR gate. That means there are different experiments in digital electronics which we perform using those TTL based logic gates. Perhaps you have performed some experiment using 74 series of chip, 7400, 7486, 7432, and all this. So all of them are designed using the transistor logic, that is TTL. Since then, and in fact, this TTL was very popular in mid-60s. And since then, there has been lots of improvement in the field of VLSI design. And that is primarily because of the advancement of the metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, which is known as the MOSFET. And nowadays, we have the logic families, which is primarily based on the metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, that is MOSFET. Now, in this particular lecture, I'll be talking about the implementation of different gates using MOS transistor. And in fact, we will be talking about what is known as CMOS architecture. So perhaps you know that the MOS transistor can be categorized into two different types. Let me just show you the symbols and the three different terminals of MOS. Like BJT, MOS is also having three different terminals. One is known as the gate terminal, which is the control terminal. Then we have the drain terminal and the source terminal. Now, the question to make the transistor on is that this gate to source voltage, VGS, should be greater than the threshold voltage of the transistor. Now, for NMOS transistor, this threshold voltage is normally positive, say 0.6 volt or 0.7 volt, this threshold voltage. And for PMOS transistor, this threshold voltage is negative. So I'm not going into the physical architecture of MOS transistor because that is beyond the scope of this particular course. But to start with, let me just tell you that in order to make the transistor on, the gate to source voltage should be greater than the threshold voltage. Now, this threshold voltage is positive for NMOS transistor and negative for the PMOS transistor. So therefore, for NMOS transistor, this VGS value should be greater than VTHN, which is positive in fact. And for PMOS transistor, now in fact, this is the architecture for an NMOS. So let me just show you, this is NMOS. And for PMOS, what we do is we identify this PMOS just by using a bubble because it's like an inverter, just an opposite of NMOS. So you know, in digital logic, whenever we want to show something which performs the inversion operation, so that is normally done just by putting a bubble. So just like this, for PMOS, this gate to source voltage, mod value of this gate to source voltage, because this gate to source voltage could have been negative, so that mod value should be greater than the VTHP of mod of VTHP. So if this VTHP is like minus 0.7 volts, so this gate to source mod value should be greater than mod of minus 0.7. That means the gate to source mod value should be greater than 0.7 volt. Now, whenever we will be using these transistors, so this is the architecture for PMOS, P-type metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. And in case of CMOS architecture, which is known as a complementary MOS, Now, both these NMOS and PMOS, they are used in the architecture. And whenever we will be using this MOS-based circuit for the design of this logic family, then we will be providing two different levels at the gate terminal. Now, in order to make the NMOS on, this gate potential is kept at the supply, that is VDD, and the source is normally connected to ground. So in order to make an NMOS transistor on, so that is, that should be the connection. Suppose we have an NMOS, so this is the gate terminal. So this gate terminal is provided with some VDD and the source is connected to ground. So as you understand, this gate to source potential is VDD, and which is higher than the threshold voltage. Normally we can keep the VDD value to be say 3 volt or 5 volt. And in fact, you must be knowing that the threshold voltage is not also constant. It depends heavily upon the architecture or the structure, physical structure of the device. Now, as you go on reducing the channel length of any MOS device, the threshold voltage is also reducing day by day. And as a matter of fact, the supply voltage can also be reduced. So nowadays you can use a supply voltage like 1.5 volt or 1.3 volt, just like that. And this drain voltage, drain terminal is kept at say VDD. Now, if you put like this, so you find that this gate to source voltage is greater than the threshold voltage. Now you can also think that, let me call this gate, I mean this drain terminal is connected to some other point in the circuit, some other point X in the circuit. So under this condition, the gate to source voltage is greater than the threshold voltage, and we can say that the transistor, this MOS, is becoming on. On the other hand, if I consider a PMOS transistor, in case of PMOS transistor, the source is connected to VDD. So this is the gate terminal. So suppose this is a source terminal. So you put a 0 volt over here at the gate terminal, and the source is connected to VDD, unlike the NMOS transistor. And this is the drain terminal. Suppose this is connected to some other point in the circuit. Let me call this is point X. Now, when you apply a 0 volt at the gate terminal, what you find is this transistor is becoming on, because the gate to source difference, that is, so this time it is negative because gate to source is minus VDD. So the mod of VGS is plus VDD, which is greater than the mod of VTHP. Now, as soon as the gate to source voltage is higher than the mod of VGS is higher than the mod of VTHP, then the PMOS transistor is becoming on. And in fact, this potential at the gate terminal acts as the control voltage to make the device on. So if I consider that there are two different voltages to apply over here, one is 0 and the second one is VDD, then if you apply a 0 volt over here at the gate terminal to an NMOS, then the NMOS is not on. So it is cut off. So the channel is not created and the device is not on. Therefore, the drain and source, these two ends, they are not connected together. On the other hand, if you consider that if you apply a voltage of VDD at the gate terminal, then you find that the source and drain, they are connected together. So we can consider the MOS as a closed switch. Similarly, for a PMOS transistor, if you apply a zero volt at the gate end, then the device is on. That means the gate to source voltage is greater than the minimum voltage required to make it on, that is the VTHP. Therefore, the device is on, and which will make the drain and the source connected together. And if you apply a VDD over here at the gate terminal, then obviously the gate to source drop is equal to zero. and which is less than the mod of VTHP. So therefore, the device is off, and therefore it cannot conduct. So you find that whenever you apply a 0 volt, one of the transistor is on, the other transistor is off. And if you apply VDD, one transistor is on, the other one is off. Now, considering these two together, these two structure together, this NMOS and PMOS together, what we can do is we can form a combined architecture like this. So I'm just copying this part first, this PMOS first. And then, so let me call this is the X, the point X, which we are talking about. So I'm just copying this part. And then I'm copying this part. And suppose I'm having a single input over here. Let the input be represented by, say, A. And this is VDD. So now we can have two different possibilities for A. So either you apply, so if I write like this, A and X. So if A is high, that means if I apply a VDD over here, if A is high, then this transistor, NMOS transistor, is on. So this one is NMOS, as you understand. So let me just write it down for your convenience. This one is PMOS, and this one is NMOS. So when A is high, that means if the potential here is equal to VDD or close to VDD, then NMOS transistor is on, and which will make the potential at X to be as low as the ground potential. Because if the transistor is on, then the drain and the source terminal can be considered to be short circuited, and the potential at X can be considered to be low, because the source potential of the NMOS device is at ground, and if the device is on, then the drain potential will also be low. That means a low resistance path. In fact, although I'm saying like the resistance is zero, that means it's a perfect short circuit, but in fact it's not perfect short circuit, but the amount of resistance offered by this NMOS at node X is very small, so that the corresponding potential over here can be considered to be low. And on the other hand, if the potential at point A is considered to be low, this time this NMOS is off, but PMOS is on, because a low voltage at the gate terminal of PMOS will make it on. So if you apply a low voltage over here, then it will make this PMOS device on, while NMOS device is off now, and the source is connected to VDD. So therefore, the source and drain is connected now through a short circuit path, and you find that at point X, the corresponding potential is high. So if I consider that A being the input of the circuit and X being the output of the circuit, then you find that it's just an inversion. So if the input voltage is high on logic one, then the output voltage is low on logic zero. And on the other hand, if the input voltage is at logic level low on logic zero, then the output voltage is at high on logic one. That means this particular circuit serves the operation of an inverter or NOT gate. So you may think that, so the Boolean expression looks something like that. So we have a single input, so you can have only two different possibilities. If zero is the input, so I think I should start from one, because if we apply the high input, that means if A is one, then X should be zero, because this time this NMOS transistor is on, PMOS is off. And if you apply A to be zero, then X is one. That means the operation rendered by this particular circuit is just of an inverter circuit. So now let us try to understand what is the limitation associated with the inverter circuit. So as you know, in the digital circuit family, NAND and NOR, these two logic gates are considered to be the universal logic gate, and you must be knowing the reason behind that. The reason is that all the logic functions can be realized using NAND and NOR logic functions. So therefore, the generation of this or implementation of this NOT gate or the inverter gate is not at all fruitful to us until and unless we design the other types of circuits. Now, to design the other types of circuits, so obviously there should be more than one input, because inverter is the only one logic gate for which there is a single input. Apart from inverter, if you consider any other logic gate like AND gate, OR gate, NOR gate, NAND gate, XOR gate, XNOR gate, or any other complicated function, you'll find that they are having multiple inputs, two or more than two inputs. So therefore, now it cannot have a single connection like this. Rather, you'll be having a connection like this. Generically, this connection can be divided into two different networks. So let me just draw the generic structure first, and then I will explore what is there inside this box. In fact, any logic function can be realized by means of these two networks. Now this is connected to VDD, and this is connected to ground. And from this point, you'll be taking the output. That is X. Now this network is known as PUN, and this network is known as PDN. So what do you mean by PUN? So PUN stands for pull up network. So I think it will be better if I just write it down the full form. Pull up network. And this one is known as pull down network. What about the inputs to each of these networks? The input being the same. So if I consider generic architecture like this, then there could have been n number of inputs. So let me call like input 1, input 2, input 3, up to input n. And the same input you will be applying over here also, the same input, same I1, same I2, I3, and IN. Now, what is the purpose of this pull-up network? So for a particular combination of this I1, I2, I3, and IN, you'll find that this pull-up network will connect this output terminal X to the supply line VDD. And that will make the supply, that will make this output terminal is equal to the logic level high. That means the purpose of this network, so obviously there are lots of MOS transistors in between this, inside this particular network. There are lots of sub-networks depending upon the complexity of the Boolean expression. And there could have been thousands of transistors in between. But for a particular combination of this I1, I2, I3, and IN, it will create a low resistance, short-circuited path from this point, from supply, to this output terminal. That means the purpose of this pull-up network is to pull up the potential of this particular output terminal at VDD. On the other hand, for a different combinations of I1, I2, I3, and IN, you will find that this pull-down network, so there also you find that a number of MOS transistors are present, and in fact, the number of transistors present in the pull-off network and the number of transistors present in the pull-down network being the same. So if you have, say, k number of transistors here, you'll find same k number of transistors over here. Now for another combination of I1, I2, I3, and IN, you'll find that those k transistors will make a short-circuited path or a low-resistance path between this point and the ground terminal. And as a matter of fact, the potential at this point X will become low. So what is the purpose of this pull-down network? The purpose of this pull-down network is to make this particular output terminal equal to the ground potential. So at any point in time, you will find that for a particular combination of I1, I2, I3, and IN, you will find that either this pull-up network will create a short-circuited path or low-resistance path between this point and X, or the pull-down network will create this path. So therefore, at any point in time, under steady-state scenario, the potential at point X could be either large or small, either high or low, under steady-state. So I'm just not considering the transient characteristics. During steady state, you will find that either of these two networks is on. So if pull-up network is on for a particular combination of these inputs, the pull-down network will be off, and vice versa. So therefore, the potential at point X will be either at VDD or at zero. That means either at logic level 1 or at logic level 0. Then the next question is that how can you ensure that so already I have told you that okay, if there are k number of transistors in this block, so there should be k number of transistors in that block also. But what transistor or what type of MOS transistor you should select in the pull-off network, and what type of MOS transistor you should select in the pull-down network? So to answer this question, you have to understand that this NMOS transistor, they can be thought of as providing strong zeros. And on the other hand, the PMOS transistors are considered to be a good choice of providing strong ones. So therefore, it is customary to use the PMOS transistors in the pull-off network and the NMOS transistors in the pull-down network. So to understand this one, this notion, let me just give you an example so that you can understand it much more clearly. Suppose I am having an NMOS device like this. And suppose I do have one capacitor, which is one capacitor is also there, which is initially charged to VDD. So we have a capacitor over here. Let me call a load capacitor CL. And we do have an NMOS device over here. Now the capacitor is charged to VDD initially. And a similar thing you can also expect for a PMOS device. And we have to understand what is the purpose over here. So second one is the PMOS. Here also this capacitor CL is charged to say VDD. Now here the purpose of placing a transistor, placing a MOS between the one end of the capacitor to the ground is to ensure that through this transistor or through this transistor, the capacitor CL will find a path to discharge. Suppose initially the capacitor is charged to VDD, and our purpose is to discharge the transistor, that discharge the capacitor. That means that transition is important, VDD to zero. Initially the capacitor is charged to VDD for each of them, and we have to use either NMOS or PMOS so that the capacitor gets discharged to 0 volt. Now to make this happen, obviously the device has to be on. Now you know that for NMOS, the corresponding potential, I mean the gate potential should be high. So let me call this potential to VDD. Now if it is high, you find that this gate to source voltage drop, voltage difference is VDD. So there is no problem. The device will become on if you provide VDD at the gate terminal. So the MOS is on, and accordingly, the transistor can be used as a switch, as a closed switch, through which the capacitor CL will find a path to discharge. So depending upon the corresponding time constant, RC time constant, because whenever the MOS is on, obviously there is a resistance, the on resistance of the MOS device. And depending upon this resistance and the value of the capacitor, so you know what about the corresponding time constant. So depending upon this time constant, ultimately the capacitor will be discharged to 0 volt. On the other hand, if I consider the scenario for the NMOS, you will find that for NMOS, for PMOS, this potential should be 0 volt, because otherwise this will not be on. So here the source potential is at VDD, because the capacitor CL is charged to VDD. So gate to source voltage difference is equal to VDD. So the device is on, fine. Now, as the capacitor discharges through this transistor, through this MOS, what happens? The mod VGS value is going to reduce, because the gate potential is at zero, is kept constant at zero, and the source potential is equal to the voltage difference or potential difference between the two plates of the capacitor, which is initially VDD, that is fine. Now, as time progresses, the capacitor will be discharging through this transistor, through this MOS, and the source potential will reduce gradually. And a point will come when this potential is equal to mod of the threshold voltage, because you know that this potential is initially VDD, which is larger than the mod of VTHP, and we are operating with a PMOS device. Now, when this potential is just equal to mod of VTHP, then if you make any attempt, if the circuit makes any attempt to further reduce this voltage, I mean, if the corresponding voltage attempts to get discharged through the transistor, through the MOS, then the MOS device will become off. Because here you find that the gate potential is equal to 0 volt and the source potential is just equal to mod VTHP. So what is the difference? The difference is equal to mod VTHP. Now, in order to make the device on, in order to make this PMOS on, this gate to source drop, that should be at least greater than mod VTHP. Now, if this voltage, suppose initially VDD is equal to say 3 volt, and suppose VTHP is equal to say 0.6 volt. So initially it is 3 volt. Now, as the time progresses, depending upon the time constant of the circuit, this potential will be reducing gradually. Then a point will come when this voltage is equal to 0.6 volt, which is equal to the threshold voltage, mod of the threshold voltage. Now, when it is equal to 0.6 volt, then the MOS device will become off, because now the gate to source drop is equal to exactly 0.6 volt. Now, that potential cannot go below 0.6 volt. That means it cannot go below zero mod of VTHP. So therefore, you find for NMOS device, it is possible to have VDD to zero. That is possible for NMOS device. But for PMOS device, this is limited to mod VTHP, because that potential cannot go beyond this mod VTHP, cannot go below this mod VTHP, then the MOS device will become off and the process of discharging will be stopped. So we find that to make strong zeros, to produce strong zeros, NMOS is the best option. So if you want to make the potential of any terminal equal to zero, then you should select NMOS. In a similar fashion, you can also describe how and why these PMOS devices or PMOS circuits are considered to be the best solution for providing the strong ones. So we can say that NMOS can produce strong zeros. The strong term is very important, strong zeros. Because mod VTHB, if you consider that VDD is at say 3 volt and mod VTHB is like 0.5 volt, so you can also consider that if it is anything higher than mod VDD by 2, that can be considered to be at logic 0. VDD is at 3 volt and the minimum voltage, the ground potential is 0 volt. So if anything is greater than 1.5 volt can be considered to be logic 1, and anything less than 1.5 volt can be considered to be logic 0. So in this regard, this mod VTHB can also be considered to be logic 0. Because that value is equal to 0 volt and this value is equal to 0.6 volt. But that is not a strong zero. That is a weak zero. Because as the potential over here approaches or comes down to 0 volt, then we can say that the strong zero has been produced. Similarly, for a PMOS, I can show you the scenario. Let us consider that, okay. Now suppose we consider a situation where the capacitor is initially uncharged. So here the operation is just the reverse. The capacitor is initially uncharged and here we have a supply over here like VDD. So this is the scenario with NMOS. And for PMOS, is connected to the drain side. So this is the ground, CL. So initially, the capacitor is uncharged. Now here the operation is to, the charging of the capacitor has to be accomplished to 0 to VDD, so that is important. So the potential at this point has to be increased. It has to be raised from 0 to VDD. So here you have the VDD over here. So obviously, in order to make the device on, NMOS on, so you need to provide VDD over here. Now, if you provide a VDD over here, initially the capacitor is uncharged, that is fine. So that drop is equal to, the gate to source drop is equal to VDD, that is good. Now, as the time progresses, this capacitor will charge through this transistor. And finally, it will try to reach to a level of VDD. But unfortunately, when the source potential is equal to VDD minus the threshold voltage, then you find that that difference between gate to source is equal to the threshold voltage. Then if you make any further attempt to increase that voltage beyond VDD minus VTHN, then obviously this transistor, this MOS will become off. And therefore, the charging phenomenon will be completed. And as a matter of fact, you find this potential, this source potential can rise from 0 to up to VDD minus VTHN. So here VTHN is positive. So if VDD is like say 3 volt and VTHN is like 0.5 volt, then from 0 volt, this capacitor can charge up to 2.5 volt. Not the 3 volt maximum. Because if their potential is greater than VDD minus VTHN, then obviously this difference will be less than VTHN, and which will make this NMOS transistor off. Now that problem is not there for a PMOS where you apply 0 volt over here. So the gate terminal is kept at 0 volt. The source is at VDD. So this one is at VDD. The source is at VDD. So the device is always on, depending upon the potential difference between the gate and source. So automatically, as the time progresses, depending upon the time constant of the circuit, this drain potential of the particular MOS will gradually reach to VDD. So therefore, 0 to VDD, so that transition is possible. So that transition is possible for PMOS device. So initially it was uncharged. So that potential is initially zero, and then it can go up to VDD. So we can say that PMOS can produce strong ones. It can produce strong ones. So you may argue that, okay, this VDD minus VTHN, so that is also large, because if VDD is like 3 volt and VTHN is like, say, 0.5 volt, then 2.5, that is also large. But it cannot be considered to be strong ones. We can consider it to be a weak one. And however, this one is considered to be a strong one. So our objective is to make VDD to zero or zero to VDD. So VDD to zero, that transition can be accomplished using an NMOS transistor. So whenever at any point in the circuit, the corresponding potential is at VDD, then you can make it zero by using NMOS as a switch. And on the other hand, in any point in the circuit, if the potential is at zero, then you can make it VDD by using the PMOS. So now, coming back to the generic architecture of the CMOS network, you'll find that this pull-up network, the purpose of the pull-up network is to make this point the output terminal, which is, in fact, so now I can write that output is basically is a function of, you must be knowing, a function of I1, I2, I3 up to IN. That is true. So here, this pull-up network, the purpose of the pull-up network is to make this point X equal to VDD depending upon the input voltage. So suppose initially it is at zero, it is at logic level zero. Now you can make it logic level one through this pull-up network. So therefore, this pull-up network consists of the PMOS device. On the other hand, suppose this X is at logic level one and you would like to make it logic level zero. Now that can be accomplished using a pull-down network, because the one end of the network is connected to the ground. So a short-circuited path, a low resistance path will be created between this node and this node by means of this pull-down network. And since the purpose is to make this terminal, the potential at point X, to be equal to zero, so therefore, that can be done, that can be executed using NMOS structures in the pull-down path. So in fact, if you just consider this inverter circuit, there also you'll find the same thing. So PMOS is there in the upper part and the NMOS is there in the lower part. So that is not only true for an inverter, but this is true always. Now, after inverter, let me just consider the very basic universal logic gate, that is the NAND function. So you know that for NAND function, the operation is if the two inputs are like A and B for a two input NAND gate, then the output is A into B whole bar. And for NOR function, it is A plus B whole bar. Now to realize this NAND and NOR function, let me just tell you another important issue regarding the connections of MOS. Because whenever you have more than two inputs, two or more than two inputs, then obviously you must be having two different MOS devices, because inverter is having a single input, so therefore only one MOS in the pull down network and one MOS in the pull up network is fine enough, is good enough. But if you have, or if you want to realize logic gates which will take into account more than one input, two or more than two input, then obviously you have to use two MOS in the pull down network at least, and two MOS in the pull up network. Now suppose, let us concentrate on two input NAND gate or two input NOR gate. Now under this condition, there should be two different inputs, so obviously there should be two different MOS. So let me just consider I'm having two different MOS like this. So I can connect, if I have two different MOS, so if I have two different MOS like this, so suppose, okay, let me just, okay, these are the two different MOS. So suppose this one is M1, this one is M2, and you must understand the corresponding terminals. So how can you connect? So you have the drain terminal, you have the source terminal, you have a drain, you have a source over here. Now how to connect? Whether this terminal, how to connect these two MOS together in a network, in a pull-up network or pull-down network. So since we have NMOS over here, so our concentration will be on pull-down network, obviously. Now, if you have two different MOS like this, now how to connect? Should I connect this point with this point and make a complicated structure, complete structure like this, or should I connect them in parallel? So there could have been two different possibilities. One is the series connection, or the second one is a parallel connection. Now for series connection, it is something like that. Both of them are NMOS. You have two different inputs. So let me call this input A and this is input B. So ultimate objective is to make a connection. So if I call this is to be this is a point X and this is a point Y. So our ultimate goal is to make a short circuited path or a low resistance path between point X and point Y. And that has to be achieved for a particular combination of the input A and B. So there could have been four different possibilities depending upon, because it's a, ultimately it's a Boolean function. So A can assume either 0 or 1. Similarly, B can assume either 0 or 1. So altogether, there could have been four different possibilities. 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Now, depending upon the architecture, so this connection, I mean, this point X and point Y can be connected together. So since both of them are NMOS, and since they are connected in the series path, so you must understand that if both of these two inputs are equal to 1, if both A and B are 1, if A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 1, then each of these two MOS, like if I call this to be M1 and this to be M2, then both of them will be on, and short circuit exists between X and Y. Short circuit or low resistance path, what you can say. Short circuit means what? We are saying that the resistance between the drain to source of each of these two MOS is equal to 0. So that's a short circuit. But practically speaking, that resistance is not 0, but very small. So instead of saying short circuit, we can also say a low resistance path exists. That means this combination will act as a closed switch. And that is possible if both A and B are kept at logic level 1. On the other hand, so that is the scenario for the series combination. Now on the other hand, if the combination is just like this, if I have a parallel combination like this, so their drain and their source, they are connected together. So this is point X, this is point Y, and you have input A over here, input B over here. Now both of them are NMOS. Now here you find that if either A or B, if at least one of the input is equal to 1, then obviously a short-circuited path will be existing between this end and that end. So here you find that A is, if I'm here, you should mention that I should mention A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 1, that combination. Here A is equal to 1 or B is equal to 1. If that condition is true, then the short-circuited path exists between X and Y. So here, for a parallel combination, out of the four different possibilities like 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, you'll find that out of four, the series combination will make this entire thing a closed switch only for A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 1. Only for one instant. And on the other hand, if you consider this one, A is equal to 1 or B is equal to 1, now this is valid 3 times. A0, B1, A1, B0, and A1, B1. then you will find that at least one of the input is 1, and therefore this X and Y, these two points are connected together. Now that is the scenario with the NMOS device. Now instead of having PMOS device, instead of having NMOS device, if you have PMOS, then obviously the requirements of the input logic is just the reverse. That means if you have a PMOS device, then in order to make the device on, the corresponding input should be at logic level 0. Suppose I am having a PMOS device over here instead of NMOS, and it is connected in the series path like this, then if both A and B, if both of them are 0, then only this low resistance path will be existing between point X and point Y. And similarly here, if I have, instead of having NMOS, if I have a PMOS device over here, then obviously if either A or B, if at least one of the input is equal to 0, then you will find that a low resistance path will be existing between this point and that point. Now, while considering the pull down network and pull up network, we have mentioned one thing, that under any circumstances, for any possible input combination, either the pull down network will be on or the pull up network will be on. So the structure should be configured in such a way that both of the two networks cannot be on simultaneously for any input combination. If you have a 0-0 combination, a 0-1 combination, a 1-0 combination, 1-1 combination, you can say any combination, then out of two different networks, at least one and at most one is on. That means one and only one network will be on. So either pull down network is on or pull up network is on. So if pull down network is on, the output will be 0, and if pull up network is on, then the output should be 1. Now let us try to understand this point from the perspective of designing a NAND gate. And in order to design NAND gate, you must be knowing that the corresponding Boolean expression is A dot B bar. And in order to ensure that at least one of the input is on, I mean on one of the network is on, either PDN or PUN, then we need to take the help of De Morgan's theorem, that is A into B bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. So that condition holds, I mean that condition holds good, and we have to take into account that particular property of Boolean function in order to realize this NAND gate. Now, as you know, for a NAND function, if both the input is equal to 1, that means if both A and B 1, then the output is equal to 0. If both A and B are on, then output is equal to 0. Now let us try to understand, let us try to investigate this structure once again. Now if both A and B is equal to 1, then you find that a short circuited path exists between this point and this point. And already you have seen that for a pull down network, this terminal is connected to ground. So therefore, if both A and B are 1, then a short circuited path, a low resistance path will exist between X and Y. And since Y is at ground potential, therefore this pull down network will make this X terminal to be at logic level low. So therefore it will direct us in designing the pull down network of the structure. So let me start with the pull down network. So you have two different MOS, the series path. So these are the two inputs. This is input A. This is input B. And this is X, which we call A dot B bar. It's an AND function. So therefore, if both A and B are 1, then so let me call this to be, say, M1 and this to be M2. So if both A and B are equal to 1, then obviously both M1 and M2, they are on. And if both of them are on, then a short-circuited path will be existing between this point and the ground terminal, and the output will become 0. So if only for A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 1, the output will be 0. So therefore, this pull down network will make this output terminal is equal to zero only for E is equal to one and B is equal to one. And you know, for other combinations of A and B, that means for 0, 1, 1, 0, and 0, 0 combination, the output will be equal to one, and that has to be accomplished by means of pull up network, because the purpose of the pull down network is to make the output equal to zero. For the other two or three combinations over here, that is the purpose of the pull down network, the pull up network, to make this output equal to one. So now the question is how to design the circuit. So in order to design the pull down, the pull up network, you have to take the help of this De Morgan's theorem. So De Morgan's theorem says that A dot B bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. So therefore, you find that this AND operation is being implemented in the series path. So if you have AND, that means it is in the series path. And here you have like an OR operation, A bar plus B bar. So since you have an OR operation, so therefore that has to be implemented in the parallel path. So now let us try to complete the design of the pull up network, that is PUN. Now the De Morgan's theorem says that it's A bar plus B bar. So therefore these two MOS should be in the parallel path like this. And what is the significance of having a bar over here? The significance is that whenever you have only logic level zero at this point, then the corresponding device will become on. So this is the pulled up network, and this is connected to supply, that is VDD, A and B. So if both A and B is equal to zero, you'll find that each of these two MOS, they are on, and obviously this pull up network will make a connection from this point to the supply. That means this potential will be at logic level high if both of them are at logic level zero. In fact, if at least one of them are at logic level zero, either A or B, then also you'll find that the corresponding MOS will become on. So if I call that this MOS to be M3 and this MOS to be M4, then you'll find that if A is equal to zero, then M3 is on, and low resistance path will be existing between this point and this point. If B is equal to zero, then a low resistance path will be existing between this point and this point through M4, and the potential at point X will become one. So let me now complete the truth table, and let us check whether okay. Let me just complete the truth table and let us try to understand which devices are on. Which devices are on? So you have four different combinations over here: 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and finally the 1, 1 combination. Now, if both of them are zero, then M3 and M4, M3 and M4, both of them are on, and the output will be at logic level one. If A is equal to zero, but B is equal to one, then only M3 is on, and X is at logic level one. And when A is equal to one and B is equal to zero, you find that M4 is on, and through M4, the potential at point X is kept at logic level one, that is VDD. Now, under these three conditions, 0, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 0, you have to understand that apart from these PMOS devices, some of the NMOS devices are also on. When A is equal to 0 and B is equal to 0, both M1 and M2, they are off. But when A is equal to 0 and B is equal to 1, apart from M3, M2 is also on. When A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 0, apart from M4, M1 is also on. But if M1 and M2, both of them are only on, then only a short circuited path will exist between this point and this point. You find that for 0-0 combination, none of them are on. I mean, none of the transistors in the pull down network are on. So therefore, there is no question of having a logic level 0 over here. So that you can also explain from different angle. For 0-1 combination, only M2 is on, this one is off. So since they are in the series path, so obviously this circuit is not closed from that particular perspective. And if A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 0, M4 is on and M1 is on. Now, if since M1 is on and since M1 is in series with M2, so therefore the potential at point S cannot be equal to 0. However, when both of them are 1, then you find that both M1 and M2 are on, and this time both M3 and M4 are off together. And since both of them are on, so you will find that this potential is at logic level 0, and you will find that M1, M2. So these two devices are on. So the from the discussion, we understand that if there are two or more than two MOS devices, if they are connected in the series path, then if all of them are on, then only a closed circuited path, a short circuited path, a low resistance path will be created. And on the other hand, if two or more than two MOS devices are connected in the shunt path or parallel path, you'll find that if at least one or more than one, if at least one device is on, then a short circuited low resistance path is being created between the two terminals. Now, this architecture is fine. Now, if the structure is, I mean, if the Boolean expression is small, like A into B bar or A plus B bar, just like this, then it is very easy to develop the functions. Now, if the circuit is complicated, or if the, I mean, if the Boolean expression is complicated, then how can you synthesize the circuit? That is also important. So, to give the answer of this question, let us take another universal logic gate first. Let us pick up this one first, and then I will give the answer to this question. Let us consider another universal gate, that is the NOR gate. That is, the Boolean expression is, I mean, I think it will be better if I write it over here, the NAND function here. That was the NAND gate. And this one is the NOR gate, so A bar dot B bar, so it's a NOR gate. So you find that A plus B whole bar. So once again, I can go back to this slide. So since you have A plus B, so obviously if any of the input is 1, the output should be 0. Now if you just consider this circuit, or a pull down network, you'll find that if any of the input is 1, either A is equal to 1 or B is equal to 1, then a short circuited path will be existing between this point and this point. And normally Y is at logic level 0, that means Y is at ground. So therefore, this will make X is at logic level 0. So therefore, this will clearly explain how we can develop the pull down network for this gate. So A plus B whole bar. So you have NMOS device. This is B, suppose this one is A. And this one is output X, that is equal to A plus B whole bar. So you must be understanding that when either of these two input is equal to 1, then a short circuited path will be existing and the output will be at logic level 0. What about the pulled up network? Now pull up network, you have like A bar dot B bar. So AND connection. AND connection clearly suggests that it's a series connection. So the series connection, you should have the devices in the in this fashion. Here you have the PMOS devices, and they must be in series. So this one is A, this one is B, and this is at VDD. Let me just name them M1, M2, M3, M4. And if I just once again draw the truth table for this one, if I draw the truth table for this one, A, B, X, and on. On means which devices are on. So like 00, 01, 10, 11. Now for 00, you find that for 00, M1 and M2, both of them are off, while M3 and M4 are on. Now if both M3 and M4 are on, so therefore X will be at logic level 1. Now for 01, M3 is on and M1 is on. M2 is on, sorry, M3 and M2. Now since M2 is on, a short circuited path will be created, and X is at logic level 0. For 10, you have M1 is on along with M4, because M4 is a PMOS device whose input is at logic level 0, therefore it should be on, and the output is 0 because M1 is on. And for 1-1 combination, both M1 and M2 are on, both M1 and M2 are on, and the output is at logic level 0. So you find that in a series path, when both of the two transistors are on, then only this will act as a closed switch, and that is happening only in the first instance for 0-0 combination. And in the shunt path or parallel path, if at least one of the devices is on, it will make a closed connection. And as a matter of fact, you find that the corresponding output potential is equal to 0. Now, if you just once again take a look at this NAND family and NAND gate and NOR gate, you'll find that once again, as I've already told, the number of transistors in the pull-up network and the number of transistors in the pull-down network being the same. And moreover, that is also equal to the number of inputs. So if you have n number of inputs in your Boolean expression, like say I1, I2, I3 up to IN, then each of the input has to be applied to each of the gates. And accordingly, you have n number of NMOS transistors in the pull-down network and n number of PMOS transistors in the pull-up network. And accordingly, you have total number of 2n number of transistors. And now if you just observe the architecture for this NAND and NOR, you'll find that if the NMOS transistors are connected in the series path, then the PMOS transistors are connected in the shunt path or parallel path. And on the other hand, if the NMOS transistors are connected in the parallel path, then the PMOS transistors are connected in the series path. So therefore, there is a duality between the connection of the transistors in the pull-up network and the pull-down network, and that is primarily governed from this De Morgan's law. And that's why this particular structure is known as the complementary MOS family or CMOS family. It is known as CMOS logic family, because when the transistors in the pull-up network are connected in the series path, then the transistors in the pull-down network are connected in the shunt path, and vice versa. And sometimes the circuit is not that simple. You can have and number of subnetworks inside a pull-up network or pull-down network. Then also you'll find that this duality property exists within the subnetworks as well. So that's why this structure of this entire architecture is known as the CMOS logic family. Now, given a particular Boolean expression, the question is how can you develop the function? That is important. Given a particular expression involving, say, five inputs, for example, A, B, C, D, E, five inputs are there. Now, how can you design the, or how can you synthesize the circuit? Then given a circuit, you can easily understand what should be the output depending upon the input combinations. You can provide the input like 0 on, and accordingly, you can check which MOS is on, and accordingly, you can decide what will be the output level. But on the other hand, suppose the Boolean expression is given to you and you have to synthesize the circuit from the looking at the Boolean expression, then how is it possible? So to understand or to answer this question, let us take the NAND expression, for example. So the expression is A dot B bar. So given an expression to you, A dot B bar. Remember, this CMOS family, so they can generate only the inverting functions. You can generate NAND function, you can generate the NOR function, you can generate the XNOR function. But in order to generate the non-inverting functions like AND function, like OR function, or like XOR function, XOR function, you have to use another inverter circuit followed by this one. That is one of the limitations of this circuit, that it cannot generate the non-inverting outputs. Only the inverting functions can be developed, NAND, NOR, NOT, XNOR, right? So given any functions, let me consider NAND function, for example. So the expression is, Boolean expression is A dot B bar, A and B bar. Now given this one, how can I synthesize? Now given this function, first of all, your first action will be to take the inverse of the Boolean expression given to you. The expression was A dot B bar or A dot B whole bar. So if you take the inverse of that, what you'll be getting? You'll be getting A dot B. Because if you take this inversion operation twice or even number of times, then obviously you can get back the original expression. So A dot B whole bar and another bar. So it will make only A dot B. Now you have A dot B. Now if you have A dot B, that means the inputs are not inverting. The inputs are like A and B. So therefore, you have to concentrate on the pull down network, because for the pull down network, the inside transistors are the NMOS transistors, and which are on by applying the logic level high, by applying VDD at their gates. So if you take A dot B, then you have to construct the NMOS devices in the pull down network in this particular fashion. And since the connection is like A dot B or A and B, so therefore they should be connected in the series path. So these two MOS, NMOS, they should be connected in the series path. And because of the presence of this bar, when both of them are on, then this output will become off. So once you complete the designing of this pull-down network, then the design of the pull-up network is very easy. Because if you have the MOS transistors in the pull-down network in a series combination, then obviously the corresponding, the associated MOS transistors should be connected in the shunt path in a pull-up network. So M1 and M3, they are associated because both of them are receiving A as input. Similarly, M2 and M4, they are considered to be associated because they are receiving B as their inputs. Now you find that M1 and M2, they are connected in series. So therefore, the corresponding transistors in the pull-up network, they should be connected in the shunt. Now that can also be validated over here also. You find that here A plus B whole bar initially as a NOR function. If you take inversion first, then it will become A plus B whole bar, another bar. So A plus B only. Now, since it's A plus B, so therefore, this NMOS devices should be connected in the series, as in the shunt path or parallel path. this will complete the design of this pull down network. Then for pull up network, the corresponding transistors M3 and M4 should be connected in the series path. Now that can be once again explained by means of another Boolean function. Let me call a Boolean function x to be like this. Suppose x is given by, for example, let me call it's like a complicated one, a into b plus c plus d whole bar. So it comprises of four inputs, a, b, c, and d. So there are four inputs. So you must understand that there should be four transistors in the pull-down network. There should be four transistors in the pull-up network. Altogether, you require eight transistors for this static CMOS logic. So first of all, you have to design the pull-down network. So the step is, if you have a Boolean expression like this, a into b plus c plus d, so therefore, and a whole bar over here, so therefore, first of all, you have to take the inversion of that, and this will make you a into b plus c plus d. So now from that, so x bar is equal to, so that is the first step, x bar is equal to a into b plus c plus d. So now you have to consider two different sub networks. You need to consider two different sub networks. So this is one sub network, so I may call this is sub network 1, SN1, and this is another one, that is SN2. So SN1 and SN2, so these two sub networks, you find that there are the plus sign or sign in between. That means these two sub networks in the pull down network, they should be connected in the parallel path, in the shunt path. So it will be something like this. I'm not drawing the total architecture right now. Rather, what I want to show is I think I can just change this one. So let me first draw the subnetworks first. So let me just change the size of the subnetwork. So that this can be accommodated properly. Take square box like this. Fine. This is one subnetwork. Let me call this SN1. And this SN1 and SN2 should be in the parallel path. So they are in the parallel path. So this is the ground line, and we'll be taking the output from this terminal. From this terminal, we'll be taking the output, that is X. Then we have to observe what is there inside SN1. Now SN1, you have two functions, A into B plus C, one AND function and another OR function. So this SN1 can further be, now within SN1, you can have this to be say SN, this to be say SN11, and this to be say SN12. And they are connected, they should be connected in the series path. because the corresponding operation in between is the AND function. So SN11 and SN12, they should be in the series path. So let me just show you with this. Okay, with this color it is fine. So they should be there in the series path. SN11 and SN12. So now within SN12, you have a function like this, B plus C. So that can be easily developed from our previous knowledge. And SN11 receives a single input, and for SN2, it receives a single input. So now I may just show it over here. So this one is SN11, this one is SN12, this one is SN2, and this entire thing, this whole thing is SN1. So SN1 and SN2, they are connected in the parallel path, and within SN1 you have two different components, like two different subnetworks, SN11 and SN12, and they should be connected in the series path because the corresponding operation in between them is the AND operation. And within SN12, you can have two different MOS transistors. Now considering this one, you can, so that completes the design of this pull down network. So that is all about the pull down network, that is PDN. Now similarly, just by applying the duality principle, you can easily derive the corresponding architecture for the pull up networks. So first of all, you have to understand that, okay, SN1 and SN2 in the pull down network, they are connected in the parallel path or shunt path. Therefore, in the pull up network, they should be connected in the series path. So they should be connected in the series path. So this one is VDD, and this one is SN2. But I can write like SN2 dash because it will comprise of PMOS devices. Now within SN1, you find this SN11 and SN12. These two are connected in the series path. So therefore, in the pull up network, this SN11 and SN12, they should be connected in the parallel path. So they should be connected in the parallel path like this. Now it completes the design of the entire circuit. So this one is SN11 dashed. This one is SN12 dashed. And this one is SN1 dashed. And obviously this SN12 dash, just like SN12, it will consist of two different PMOS devices. So altogether you have four devices in the pull down network and four devices in the pull up network. So SN11 will consist of one NMOS, SN12 will consist of two NMOS, and SN2 will consist of one NMOS. So altogether 1 + 2 + 1, that is 4. Here also you have 4, so altogether 4 plus 4, ultimately you have altogether 8 MOS devices. Now we can validate this one. First of all, we have to draw the structure, because this is a block diagram, what you have mentioned over here. Now we have to identify the individual elements. So A into B plus C plus D. So the operation is X equal to what you mentioned is A into B plus C plus D whole bar. So to start with, first of all, you have to take the inversion of X, that is X bar, which will give us A into B plus C plus D. So therefore, these two are in the shunt path. Now A and B plus C, so these two are in shunt path. So now you can understand that A and B plus C, so they should be in series. So I'm drawing from the input A. So A, this input is being provided to SN 1 1, and the corresponding MOS is in series with SN 1 2. Now SN 1 2 will consist of two different MOS devices which are in the parallel path, because the combination is like B plus C. So these two are in parallel. These two are in parallel. D and C. So this completes the design of SN1. So you have SN11 in series with SN12. So this one is SN11. This one is SN11. And this one is SN12. And these together will give you SN1. And this should be in parallel with SN2. Sorry, so I think I can continue with the same color. This will be in parallel with SN2. For which the input is D. Now this completes the design of the pull down network. Now what about the pull up network? So first of all, this SN1 dashed and SN2 dashed, they should be in the series path. So they should be in the series path. Now within SN1 dashed, you have these two which are in the series path in pull down network. So therefore, they should be in the shunt path in the pull up network. So just the reverse. Let me take this connection from here only. So it will be a PMOS. The input is A, and this should be, this SN11 dashed should be in parallel with SN12 dashed. Now in pull down network, it was in series with SN11. I think it was called SN12. Yeah. In pull down network, this SN11 was in series with SN12. Therefore, in pull up network, this SN11 dashed should be in parallel with SN12 dashed. Now SN12 dashed, B and C must be in the series path. So they must be in the series path. So you have to apply the duality principle over here. So this is input B, this is input C. So this completes the design of SN11 dashed. And in this SN1 dashed, and this SN1 dashed should be in series with SN2 dashed. And you have this one. So this one is D, and your final output is obtained from this point, that is X, which is equal to A into B plus C plus D whole bar. Now we have to obviously check whether this structure is correct or not. So for that, what is to be done is, first I may write the Boolean expression A into B plus C plus D whole bar. And let me just, as you know, there could have been 16 possibilities. There could have been 16 possibilities because A, B, C, and D can take on two values, either 0 or 1. And since you have 4 inputs, A, B, C, and D. So let me check how far I can incorporate over here. Then X. I don't know how far I can incorporate. Anyway, let me just start. 0, 0, 0, 0. 0, 0, 0, 1. 0, 0, 1, 0. 0, 0, 1, 1. 0, 1, 0, 0. 0, 1, 0, 1. 0, 1, 1, 0. 0, 1, 1, 1. 1, 0, 0. 1, 0, 0, 1. 1, 0, 1, 0. So I have taken almost many of them. A, B, C, D, and X. Okay, so 1010, after that you have 1011, 1100, 1101, 1110, 1111. 16 possible combinations. So now you find that if all of them are 0, then obviously the output should be 1. Now if D is equal to 1, then the output should be 0. That is obvious, because if one of the input is 1, the output should be 0. So let me just fill up this point. D1, then output should be 0. What about the rest? Here, I have to consider A into B plus C only. Now, A is equal to 0. Then obviously, it will make it 0, 0. Then it will become 1. Then this one, A into B plus C. If A is equal to 0, obviously it will make it 0. This will 1. Then this will be also 1. A plus B plus C, 1 into 0. This is also 1. Now if A is equal to 1, B and C, both of them are 0, then it is also 1. Now this time you have A into B plus C will become 1. So this time it will be 0. This time also 0. And this time also 0. So we find that out of 16, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 times it is 1 and rest 11 times it is 0. Now we have to check whether this is correct or not. So that can be done using any arbitrary, or I can also consider all of them. So what we find is, it is very difficult to impose each of them, I mean both of them parallelly. Anyway, so if all of them are 0, the output is 1. The first combination says that if all of them are 0, then output should be 1. Now that can be verified, that if all of them are 0, that means B, C, D, or A, B, C, D. So I think it will be better if I call them by names. M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, M6, M7, M8. Now if all of them are 0, then all the MOS in the pull-up network will become on M5, M6, M7, M8. All of them are on, and this will make the output to be 1. Then you consider, say, 0001, the next one, 0001, the output should be 0. So if D is equal to 1, then M4 is 1. M4 is on if D is equal to 1, and the low resistance path will be created through M4, which will make this output to be 0. So if D is equal to 1, the output is always 0. So these different cases can be justified. So I'm not considering this one. Let us take this one, 0010. 0010, the output is to be 1. 0010. So if A is equal to 0, then M5 is on. If B is equal to 0, M6 is on. If C is equal to 1, M7 is off. And if D is equal to 0, then M8 is on. So 0010. That means B is on, but C is off. Therefore, this path is not closed. However, this path is closed. That means this M5 is on and M8 is also on. And this will make the output to be 1 through this path, through M5, M8 combination. Similarly, you can take any other arbitrary combination. You can also take 0111 combination. 0111 combination, the output is equal to 0. 0111. So obviously, if D is equal to 1, output should be 0. There is no doubt about that. Because if D is equal to 1, output is always 0. You can take some other cases like 1000. The output is 1. 1000. Now, if it is like 1000, output is 1, so we have to take into account the pulled up network. 1000. So if A is equal to 1, M5 is off. But B and C, both of them are 0. That means M6, M7, both of them are on, and M8 is also on. Therefore, the output will become on through this M6, M7, M8 combination. And at the same time, through this 1000 combination, this pull down network is not on. Because if with 1000 combination, M1 is on. But M2, M3, and M4, all of them are off. So therefore, being M1 to be on only, this pull down network cannot connect this point X to the ground terminal. So the output will become 1. So with 1000, the output is 1. So you can take another one, like I may consider, like say, a 0010 case, the penultimate case, 0010. The 0010 we find. With 0010, what we find is, with 0011, this M5, M6, and M7, both of them are off. So therefore, even if M8 is on, because of the inactivity of this subnetwork SN1 dashed, the output cannot be equal to 1. What about the pull up? What about the pull down network? With 0110 case, you find that since M1 is on because A is equal to 1, and both B and C are on. I mean, the input combination is 1110, so only M4 is off. But M1, M2, M3, all of them are on. So therefore, a short circuited path will be created through M1 and this M2, M3 combination, and which will make the output to be 0. And that can be also verified from this 0110 case. Similarly, with 1100 case, you find that 1100 case, if C and D both are 0, then M3 and M4 are off, but M1 and M2, these two transistors are on. So therefore, you find that A and B, with A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 1, and C is equal to 0 and D is equal to 0, M1 and M2, these two transistors are on, and this will make the output to be logic 0. So if you are provided with a complicated functions like this, A into B plus C plus D whole one like this, or any complicated function, then your first step is to invert the function, and then depending upon the series parallel combination, I mean AND or combination, you have to implement the NMOS logic first, I mean the pull down network logic first, and based on the duality theorem of the De Morgan's theorem, duality property of the De Morgan's theorem, you can design the pull up network accordingly. Now, in case you are provided with some non-inverting Boolean expressions, like instead of providing A into B plus C plus D whole bar, if you are given with A into B plus C plus D, in that case, you should not put the inversion sign initially. You can go on with your synthesis without putting an inverter right at the beginning. But you have to remember that what you are developing is for an inverted output. And to get the final output or the exact output after designing the circuit, then you should put an inverter over here. For example, instead of giving, like, suppose x equal to A into B plus C plus D, and suppose I would like to generate, or I would like to develop this function A into B plus C plus D. So you don't have any inverter over here. So if you do not have an inverter over here, then you should not start with an inversion operation. You develop this one just like this, but that time this output is not equal to your A into B plus C plus D, rather A into B plus C plus D whole bar. In order to make it A into B plus C plus D, what is needed? That is connected to a simple inverter circuit. So this will be to our Y, and this is VDD. Right. So by means of this, you can develop different types of logic families, I mean different types of Boolean functions using this CMOS, complementary MOS logic family. And the biggest advantage of this complementary MOS logic family is that the static power loss can be made very small, because you find that whenever the pull down network is on, then the pull up network is off and vice versa. So from VDD to supply, you don't find any constant current flow, because in any case, for any combination of the inputs, either this pull-up network or the pull-down network is on. You don't find any situation when both of these two networks are on. So therefore, a constant power, constant current flow between this VDD point and the ground point is never true for this CMOS logic family, and which can reduce the power consumption to a significant extent. So that is the biggest advantage of this CMOS logic family. And the second advantage is coming in terms of the area utilization, or as far as the hardware complexity is concerned, because you know nowadays, with the development of the VLSI technology, the MOS transistors can be designed on a very small area of a silicon chip. And as a matter of fact, more and more transistors can be implemented, can be embedded within a small geographical area and small chip area. And as a matter of fact, the compactness of the structure circuit has been enhanced significantly. And for the design of any logic functions, there are certain issues like the power minimization, then the area minimization, and obviously the speed is also an important factor. So in this regard, this CMOS logic family is providing a very good option as compared to the previous logic families like RTL, DTL, NTTL, and so on. So with this, I would like to conclude our discussion on this particular unit on logic family.